His light shining, His love radiating. Everyone, including you and each and every one of us, are there. And we're feeling the love and the peace and the joy and the hope. For this is your journey. This is your time. This moment in time. The thoughts you think, the love you share, are all part of your personal resurrection. What is it at this time no longer serves you? What would you like to release? Take a moment and place these thoughts and feelings, actions, behaviors that no longer serve you in the hands of Spirit. In your mind fully to receive the guidance and the support that awaits your request. Place your heart, your mind in the hands of love. Set your intention this holy week to go forth in love. So that our resurrection, a week from today, may be real to each and every one of us. Holy Spirit, we place our minds and our hearts in your hands. May we keep our eyes fixed on your love, your guidance and your support, so that we may co-create a community that serves your will in love. So it is. Thank you. Thank you, Ed and Vicki. Beautiful. And interestingly, you know, this is very strange. On my phone, I do silence it, but only here, and I swear only here, on an occasional Sunday, Siri pops up and like leaves a little message. And she said, "Who, me?" when that little ding happened, so I have no idea who me. So whatever that means, I don't know. But maybe that's a question we need to ask ourselves. And I'm going to ask Mary to come up, and before she speaks, I would like to say that I spoke to Iris yesterday, and she had fully planned to be here. I was looking so forward to seeing her, as well as everyone else here today, and she's got some health issues. Nothing, I don't think, too serious. She has a cyst on her spine right now that's causing her a lot of pain. And they're going to do surgery in May, and she asked that we keep her in our prayers, and let's just zap her with all our love and healing energies, and know that she will overcome this and be back to her wonderful, healthy self. And one other little request for prayer. We all love our four-leggeds. Our friend Lloyd, who you know that Lloyd and Ken Kinnett, who used to come here, moved to Atlanta. Ken passed away last year, but Charlie, their Jack Russell is the cutest dog and so sweet, and Lloyd's companion and love and such a sweet, special dog. He's having some serious health issues, and I know Lloyd is really worried about that. So she asked for prayers. So keep Lloyd and Charlie in your prayers, and just send Lloyd some comfort and Charlie some healing prayers. Okay.
Good morning. Good morning. Siri's query, who, me? Yes, me. And you. Holy Spirit, Mother, Father, God, on this new day, this new beginning, may each of us open our hearts to receive and accept the truth of who we are. We are spirit. We are beings of light and love. We are holy. We are loving. Open your heart to accept this truth. Accept your power to heal. Through God's loving grace, as you hold in your heart someone dear, a situation of any kind that requires healing and blessing and love and peace, bring this situation or individual into your open heart, that central shining place of love that dwells within each and every one of us. And I invite you to place yourself in your holy space. As we say, thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for delivering us to our truth.
Thank you for delivering us to our radiance.
Thank you for delivering us to our power to heal.
Thank you for delivering us to love.
And so it is.
Amen. Namaste.
Blessed be.
Blessed be. Amen. Thank you. Amen. Blessed be is right. Well, it's not time for that yet. So, anyway, let me just get situated here. I'll turn this off. I have a joke. I know you've missed the jokes.
Well, maybe
yeah.
Yeah.
This one's actually really funny, I have to admit. You know? Up. Oh, iHeartRadio. Okay, thank you. Okay, so. Okay, so. Maybe some of you guys have heard it. But anyway, there was a female CNN journalist who heard about a very old Jewish man who'd been going to the Western Wall to pray twice a day, every day for a very, very long time. So she went to check it out. She went to the Western Wall, and there he was, walking slowly up the holy site. She watched him pray, and after about 45 minutes, when he turned to leave, using a cane and moving very slowly, she approached him for an interview. "Pardon me, sir. I'm Rebecca Smith from CNN. What's your name?" "Morris Feinberg," he replied. "Sir, how long have you been coming to this Western Wall to pray?" "For almost 60 years. 60 years? That's amazing. What do you pray for?" "I pray for peace between the Christians and Jews and the Muslims. I pray for all the wars and all the hatred to stop. I pray for all our children to grow up safely as responsible adults and to love their fellow man. I pray that politicians tell us the truth and put the interests of the people ahead of their own interest." "Well, how do you feel after doing this for 60 years?" "Like I'm talking to a frickin' wall." Yeah, sometimes, doesn't that feel like the truth sometimes? I think sometimes we feel like we're just talking to a freaking wall, but there is a divine plan, and I'm sure it's unfolding in its own perfect way. But anyway, so here we are, beginning of Holy Week, Palm Sunday, and beautiful, beautiful time of year, because not only do we really get to experience Holy Week and all its power and strength, but look at the beauty outside. Now the craziness, as we know, the weather that we had on our trip was insane. Where it was supposed to be hot, it was cold. It rained, it almost snowed, and I know you all got lots of insane weather. But today, this is Palm Sunday weather at its best. You know, it's beautiful out. You know, where else can you be? Have snow a few days earlier and be 80 degrees as it's going to be tomorrow, right? It's crazy, but just love and enjoy it all. But anyway, so as we know, this Holy Week is really, recounts the series of events that led to the resurrection of Christ a week from today. And, you know, it's so powerful, you know, to experience it beyond just words. It's a journey beyond words. It's a journey to the heart. It really is a journey to each and every one of our own personal resurrections. And it's symbolic. And, you know, I do believe that that the events happened as stated, as taught. But I think that there's even a deeper meaning of the symbolism behind them, and really what they stand for and what they mean. And it does, so it doesn't matter if you believe or buy into the story or not, but it is a great metaphor for our own personal resurrection. And I, as I said in the meditation, I don't think that Jesus coming in on the donkey to Jerusalem, you know, with the people cheering and loving on him and just, you know, so delighted he was there, to say the least. It was a journey for all of us. He was there to just be that space of love. And so it it really doesn't matter, as I said, if you go by the historical teaching or just the metaphorical. It's a great story. As I shared earlier, it was 2016 was a year that that was one I choose to let go and move forward. I look today, this holy week, this end of sabbatical, coming back to my spirit family, as a new beginning for not only me, but for all of us and for our center. And I feel so excited and grateful about all the possibilities. And I also get that that there's some work for each and every one of us to do to get there. And we can do it, and we will do it, and we are doing it. And that work is, to me, resurrection consciousness. And we've got a week to do it, okay? So we are here today. It's a new beginning. We have this great message from our land from that Mark shared with us earlier today. This beautiful meditation, this coming home, this whole newness that is surrounding us right now. Oh, how blessed are we? It's fascinating. It's awesome. And the only thing that will impede us from really moving forward is holding on to old beliefs, holding on to resentments and judgments. I know a few people have said, so what messages did you get from your sabbatical? Not many. I mean, I'm not going to sit here and say, oh, you know, with the, you know, coming back, you know, whatever. Basically, to have the opportunity to be in nature, not to worry about a thing. Stress. I was carrying so much stress. I didn't realize it till I let it go. And I've committed to myself, I'm not going to carry that stress anymore. It's ridiculous. I'm not getting into drama. It serves no one. I have my own drama in the past. It's done. I'm not getting into other people's drama. It's just, it's a waste of energy and time. I really want to use this Holy Week, this sabbatical time, this spiritual gathering as an opportunity to be reborn, literally, in spirit and in love. I will say, I'd spoken to Jerry earlier. She said she appreciated my posts on Facebook that were from Yogananda and Paramahansa Yogananda. And I do find that he is just such so resonant to my heart. I've always been a Course in Miracles student for 30 years plus. I love the Course in Miracles. Yogananda's teachings are very compatible. I think truth is truth, you know? It makes, for some reason, right now it's making it personal for me, his teachings. And so just these little blips, you know, I would just, maybe a paragraph or a few sentences would be all I needed every day just to sort of set the tone for the day and just sort of get my thinking in the right place. I've always resonated with his teachings. And it is that, you know, as I keep being reminded, all of our experiences of our life, every thought, every word, every deed has brought us to this moment in time. And so where are we gonna go from here? We really need to question and ask. Yeah, I had an opportunity. We went to see my mother last week in West Virginia. And it was wonderful, as always, to see her. She's definitely sadder than last time I saw her. And has her moments. Ellen actually got her to smile, which was amazing. You know, I spent time with my sister Suzanne and her husband Lee, and I watched them, and she's now chairman of the board of the church that we grew up in, and my father grew up in, and his family grew up in, and my mother. It's a big old church. And there was a fellow who was chairman for 50 years, and he asked Suzanne to take that role on. I don't know if she's going to do it for 50 years, but anyway, I have to say, I really was so appreciative of just watching Suzanne and Lee and how they just, you know, they're not people who, I doubt, I don't think that they meditate really. I'm sure that they pray. I don't think that they go to too many seminars, if any at all. They do go to church every Sunday, but they're just living like they're just good people, and really good people, and giving people, and kind people, and servants. And every morning she was like, thanks for staying with Mom, because I got to be at church at 7. They're doing a renovation, and she was at church every day, all day, and she was cleaning out boxes and meeting with movers, and, you know, coming, she showed up one day just looking like bratty as could be, because she'd been working all day, and that made me think, you know, this, it's about living the message. It's that time, you know. Yes, I love seminars, and I love, you know, meditation, and I love all of this, and I think it's helpful, don't get me wrong, but at some point, I think we have to make that transfer of like looking out here for all the answers and knowing that we are that already and living from that place. I think that's what this Holy Week gives us the opportunity to do, to really devote our hearts to living the message, living from our hearts totally. And I am preaching to the choir here. I mean, this group is so loving and giving and kind and compassionate and understanding. Don't get me wrong, it's a wonderful group of people, but I just think that if we're going to truly ground ourselves in our purpose, it's about being holy in every moment. What would love do here? You know, next week, let's expect, you know, ascension. And doesn't mean we're all going to necessarily leave and ascend, but the ascension in consciousness. I know you two want to ascend literally, and so if we don't see these two or hear them, and maybe that'll happen too, and that's okay. But the thing is, how do we do that? Yogananda, a couple of things that I wanted to share. He says, draw on God for the solution of all your problems. Do not allow your courage and quick to be paralyzed when overwhelming difficulties suddenly come down like an avalanche. Keep awake your intuitive common sense and your faith in God, and try to find even the slenderest means of escape, and you will find that means. All will come out right in the end, for God has hidden his goodness behind every superficiality of the paradoxes of mortal circumstances. So I get that is like, yeah, there's a lot of circumstances, a lot of stuff we could get sucked into, upset, angry, and fearful about. But if we just keep our faith, knowing that I am divine, you are divine, there is a divine plan, our resurrection will manifest. You know, remember this. This is one, I know that in the past, this sabbatical, I took things way too personal. That's a life lesson for me. It's like, well, shoot, you know, well, whatever. I think we can all relate to that. And I'd get pissed, to be honest, and hurt and sick. And I read this one and I'm like, this is true. No one or nothing can hurt me because I have no ambition except for God. I wish anger on no man, and no one can provoke me by display of anger. So strive to be peaceful, self-controlled, and sincere. Otherwise, the wrong behavior will negate the effects of meditation. Every spiritual thought you think will be your eternal friend, and every evil inclination or ego inclination you acquire will be your enemy for a long, long time. Instead of enemy, maybe obstacle. It will pursue you until you slay it. Remember, I am pointing you to the step-by-step method to God. Make your life more simple. To me, it's nothing new. It's what I've always believed. I just think it sort of like just settles in more and more and more. Like I said, I didn't have any epiphanies, any difference, but I did have a change of heart. Stress, I guarantee, is not good for anybody. I think we can all relate to that. Stress can create a lot of problems, a lot of upset, a lot of anger and sickness. So it really is the opportunity this week to let go, be led, you know, be still and ask, okay, where would you have me go? What would you have me do? What would you have me say and to whom? And be willing to let Spirit just take us on the entire journey of the week to resurrection. Because if we set that intention, it will be ours to have. I've got a ton of other things. I think I've shared the crux of the message because I could go on here forever, but I'm looking at the clock and I think we got it. So next Sunday, it's really about us just showing up and using this week as a means of awakening. But I will close with this. The message of Palm Sunday is the recognition that we can become authentically translucent to our interior light of being, which shining outward allows us to see through the world and temporal reality to the eternal things that are truly real. Take this week to heart. All of your thoughts, words, deeds, and actions have brought you to this moment. What serves your resurrection and what doesn't? Be still and know that you are divine, and may we all join Christ in the resurrection this Easter. Peace Amen. And love prevail on earth, and so it is.
Amen.
Namaste.